I ask, O God Almighty, that you may meet every heart at their point of need, O God. Wherever or whatever it is that I may not articulate well, Holy Spirit, I pray that you may do what you do best. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Now, I want you to turn to your neighbor and tell them the 10th instruction. Then ask them whether they know what the 10th instruction is. So I called this the 10th instruction because it's in reference to the 10 commandments. Now, who can tell me what the 10th commandment is? Going once, going twice. Ama nyinyi ufuata tu wade wenye hukuja. Sindio, to make it easy. So the reason why I called this particular commandment the 10th instruction is because, you see, in a fallen state, the mind is can be very deceiving. You call it a commandment and the mind goes into defensive mode. So you are unable to, you're already disqualifying or qualifying yourself as to whether you are a follower of this law. But when you look at it from the point of it being an instruction, it's one that guides you. It's one that influences you to walk circumspectively in the ways of God. Now, before I even reveal what the 10th instruction is, I'll just be doing a summary, by the way, of what Bishop has taken us through. And I thank the Lord for being in the Spirit. It is often said that the best solutions in most cases is the most obvious one. Sindio, sometimes when you're faced with a very complex problem, you're busy, you know, rattling your brain to find out what best way can I tackle this. Sometimes the answer is staring at you in the face. And it's the most obvious approach. But this is not the case, especially for our generation. And why is it? It is because man has become enthralled by complexities. We want to complicate things. We like the idea of things being complex, being complicated, you know. And it's interesting because when we do that, that obvious approach is disregarded in pursuit of a complex means to the end. It's disregarded and the obvious thing ends up being called another name. And the name is mystery. Think about it. When Christ is speaking and people are saying this is a mystery, he's not dumbfounded by it. For him, it is the most obvious thing. It's the most obvious thing, and it's the thing that we ourselves are supposed to walk into and realize, hey, by the way, the answer to this problem is very simple. But we like complexities. Ecclesiastes 7:29. There's another man who saw this trend, Solomon. And he says, this only have I found. God created mankind upright, but they have gone in search of many schemes. God created the idea of us pursuing righteousness to be very simple, but we have gone and made it very complicated. Tell your neighbor the 10th instruction. Now, because man has decided to search after many schemes, there is one scheme in particular, which is in this 10th instruction, that has a very high body count. People drop like flies because of being ignorant to it. You see, I don't know, you guys watch movies, but have you ever seen this case where the good guys are trying to rescue a hostage in the bad guy's compound and it's heavily guarded and secured, and they're strategizing and they're saying, okay, this is how we're going to go to save the person, we're going to run through the front door, take out everyone, and then they set their plan in motion, and they run and they run, and then all of a sudden they start dropping. It's like they're being shot from somewhere, but they don't know where. Yes. You know, they're running, hey, we should be making progress, but guys are just falling. And it's only in the wisdom of the general who picks up and says, hey, there's a sniper on the rooftop. Uh-huh. He's the one who's taking guys down. So, and because we have family, I want your part of your joke. Okay, sour. And because we have family, we have to find a solution to the problem. So for those who are still floating, go watch Fast and Furious. You'll understand why. Yeah. So it takes the wisdom of the general to say, hey, take out the sniper, and then the advancement becomes easier. And the thing about this scheme, just like the sniper, it's lodged at the highest point. What is the highest point here on Earth? Mount Everest. Now let me ask another question. What is the highest point in the spirit? There, we have it. Summit of the heart. That's the highest point. And just to give an example, the parable of the rich fool, Jesus says that this guy said unto his soul, he said in his soul, he said it at the highest point of his elevation that he will get more. And God says an angel of the Lord came and took his life. Nebuchadnezzar had seen his reign and had exalted himself to the highest point of his heart. And God comes and makes him eat grass. The highest point of in the spirit is where your heart is. And this is where this deadly scheme latches or lodges itself. It is so high that not even me, as looking at you as an individual, can help you if you do not yourself know what has lodged itself there. So this 10th instruction can be found in Exodus 20, verse 17. And I'll read. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his male or female servant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. You just learned about jealousy. I will repeat. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his male or female servant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. Now, let us go into a bit of definition. The word covet and desire mean the same thing. And to help me just hit the nail on the head so that we get rolling, I want to juxtapose this verse with another verse, which is also of complex nature, which is Psalms 37, verse 4, which says, delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you what? The desires of your heart. So, in one aspect, God is saying, you shall not covet anything that belongs to your neighbor. And in another aspect, he says, delight in me and I will give you the desires of your heart. So what is covetousness? Covetousness is the inordinate desire for something. It is excessive. But that is English. Let me put it now in spiritual terms, as was said by Bishop. Covetousness is your attempt to prosper without God. It is the steps you take, to prosper without the reverence or the fear of God in your life. Covetousness is the... All right, come in. It is the steps you take to prosper without God. It is the steps you take that disregards the fear and the reverence of God in your life. Remember, covetousness and desire mean the same thing. It is, and I'll tell you where the distinct difference is. Covetousness is the mother of all sins because it sets its foundation at the highest point in the spirit, which is your heart. That is where its vantage point is, at the height of your heart. That is where covetousness sits. And I was finding it very interesting that it happened to be the 10th instruction. I would think that I would have placed it as number one, to be honest. Because if you understand the wisdom of and the benefits of this 10th instruction, so many things would be easier for us. It is the mother of all sin because the sin of covetousness is conceptualized in the heart before it finds expression. To use an analogy, covetousness is a dead carcass that spawns the maggots of every other transgression. It is from covetousness that you would find the expression of killing, of committing murder. It is from covetousness that you will find yourself walking in adultery. It is in covetousness that you will find yourself bearing false witness to your neighbor. It is from that carcass that every other evil deed manifests. If I was to offer an alternative of why this 10th instruction was given the way it was given, I would say this is God saying to you, there are desires I will not grant. There are desires in your heart I will not grant. Now that's tough pill to swallow because we've been raised in a generation where we are told the promises of God are yes and amen. We are told delight in the Lord and he will give you desires. He wants all these good things for me, the head and not the my barns to be full, my storehouses to be plenty, barrels filled with grain, all those things. But yet he says, you shall not covet. So given that most of us at this point have already qualified or disqualified ourselves as covetous, so then the next question should be, how does a covetous desire look like? Uh-huh. Now, let me use a few examples. There's a story of Amnon, one who was very much infatuated by the half-sister. He never used to sleep, to the point where he became sick in order to have this lady. There's another man by the name of King David who saw a lady and desired her to the point where he committed murder. There's another man by the name of King Ahab who saw a farmer's vineyard by the name of Naboth and desired it to the point of killing. Now, what was the outcome of this covetous desire? There was death. Amnon died. The child of Bathsheba, born out of a covetous desire, died. King Ahab died. The one who influenced King Ahab, Jezebel, died. I will come back to that point. Now, what is the distinct difference? Any desire in your heart, any desire, simple or complicated, grand or small, any desire in your heart that does not lead you to a state of contentment is covetous. This is the reagent that tests a litmus paper to know whether it's blue or red. It is contentment. If you have a desire in your heart and it does not lead you to contentment, you're walking on the corridors of covetousness. Uh-huh. And it is only a matter of time before it gets hold of you. Because what covetousness does is that it stops you from seeing the intervention of God in your life. It stops you from seeing the intervention of God in your life. Everyone else around you can see what God is doing in your life apart from your own. Because you are so exalted. You are at the highest point. You've been captured at the highest point of your existence, which is your heart. So me telling you that, hey, God is still faithful, look at 1, 2, 3 things that have happened and that is a testimony of God's doing, you will be ignorant of it. You will despise it. You will say, that's too small, that's not what I wanted, that's not what I like, I wanted this and that. Ni kama kuchezea mbuzi guitar, because you cannot be told because of the height in which you have let this scheme take root and shape. Rev. Richard once said, peace should be the fruit of every prayer you make. And let me add on to it and say, contentment should be the envelope that you seal all your desires in. Every desire that you have should have a level of contentment, not only in what is to come, but also where you are. Contentment is the delight that God seeks after. Contentment and trust in God are like fraternal twins. They are satisfied in who God is, what he says, and what he promises to do. If you've ever gone into fasting and prayer, and you've come out more frustrated than ever because of the desire that you went with, chances are you are being influenced by a covetous impulse. There is something you wanted, but you made it so excessive that you failed to see even the mercies of God. You pray, you come out more frustrated. Chances are God is telling you, it is not that I have denied you the substance of your request. I have rebuked the posture you're coming with. I have rebuked the posture that you are entering my presence with. Not the substance of the request. It is your posture. And that is what this scheme does. It lies to you. It causes something as simple as being in the presence of God look so complicated. Because what it does also is that it paints God, it changes your perspective about who God is. Uh-huh. It slowly takes in and plants in your head an idea. Hey, manze, God, man, God is a tyrant. Hey. God is not as merciful as I thought. God is not a God of second chances. God is not a God who is interested in my welfare. He's interested in me having other things. And what that does, it forces you to replace that understanding of who God is with another understanding of your own about who God is. And it forces you to be covetous, to desire, to set forth schemes that will corrupt your heart, your mind, and also those around you. Are we together?
Yes, we are.
Tell your neighbor the 10th instruction.
The 10th instruction.
Covetousness is an obscure sin. Most of us will not be overtaken by deeds of the flesh because at this point in time we are very clever. You know what you should not or not do. Mm-hmm. But many of us can easily be overtaken by the defilement of the spirit because it cannot be seen. And that is what covetousness does. It defiles your spirit. It sets in motion a series of events. If not redirected, will lead to the corruption of your whole mind, body, and soul. Back to the analogy of the carcass. As I said, covetousness is like a dead carcass that spews maggots. And I want that analogy to sink in. So the next point in time when you're going to prayer, and to pray to God, you will understand the posture and the display that you need to go with. The end result of every covetous desire, because you see, sometimes this world has its own way of giving something, the counterfeit, presenting a counterfeit viewpoint by showing, fine, I had a covetous desire and my prayer was still answered and look at me now, I am prospering. Go back to the examples I gave of Amnon, David, and King Ahab. The end result is death. No two ways about it. It's shown in scripture, and there are very many other examples. Once you allow covetousness to take you fully, TikTok, death sentence. And that is why God is very adamant in saying, please do not covet. And first and foremost, delight in me. Because anything that you're coveting for, God has factored it in his plan for you. I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. That's the song we've just sung. He's factored your welfare. Because you see, covetousness tells you that God is not interested in my own welfare, whether tangible or not tangible. It tries to convince you that God is not interested in these things that you go through each and every day. And so it puts you in a position whereby, you know what, since I can't trust in God to handle this particular issue, let me trust in my own understanding. Mm-hmm. But then we go to Psalms, and he says, no, is it Proverbs? It's Proverbs. Trust not in your own understanding, because it will lead you to that place where the spirit of covetousness ensnares you. This is a message that I want us to think about as a message of liberty and a message that will set us free. Covetousness anchors itself on the spirit of misunderstanding.
Hey.
You see, misunderstanding is all about perspective.
Uh-huh.
I can stand from this side and see it as it is. Goshi will stand on this other side and see it as it is. If we are not going to cross and see from each other's perspectives, there will always be a misunderstanding in how we relate. So on one hand, God wants me to prosper, to have all these beautiful things. After all, he promised the Israelites a land of milk
and
honey and big fruit and grapes. And they went and they ate it. See, they received it. Wasn't it a tangible request? Did they experience the land of Canaan to be greater than even the land of Egypt? Yes. But then again, hey, God says in Luke 12:15. Luke 12:15, and he said to them, take heed and beware of covetousness, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of the things he possesses. I'm like, okay. So on one hand, you're telling me that these things I'm asking for, I should not make them to be about my life, but yet I need these things. So from one perspective, yes, God wants to improve my situation. But on another perspective, he's saying, take heed and beware.
Yeah.
Now, what the spirit of covetousness does, it makes sure that those two revelations never meet.
Uh-huh.
They remain separate, far from each other,
uh-huh.
so that they never meet. And if they never meet, everyone will have their own interpretation about what God wants for them. And if they experience a level of frustration in it, they take upon themselves the spirit of covetousness in saying, okay, I will do it my way. I will be desperate and I will make sure it works, because that's what the spirit of this age does, especially for us millennial generations. Fast-paced world, my brother is succeeding, I seem to remain at the same spot. This one is acquiring this, I seem not even to acquire the toy version of the equivalent. You know, it becomes a very pressurized environment to the point where, and that's the culture, that's the hive that the spirit of covetousness creates. That part of desperation, that part of, I need to make it, I need to succeed, hustle hard, do this, do this, do this. But yet God says, I provide for my children as they are asleep. That perspective, the spirit of covetousness doesn't want those two sides to meet, so that you can continue on the path that you are on. You will think you're okay, but you're not. Christ refers to the Pharisees as, outside you're like whitewashed tombs, very clean, very presentable, but deep inside you're rotten because of that spirit of covetousness. You guys have seen the I don't know if it's a sport, acrobats usually do it. When they're walking a tightrope. If you're walking a tightrope, what is the one thing that you do other than have a safety net? It's what?
Balance.
You extend your left and right hand to ensure that there is a balance as you're walking. Or you're given a very long like pole to support that balance. The vacillation of your heart between these two truths of whether I should seek after these things or probably abandon them needs to be centered, and it is done with the spirit of contentment. Mm. Mm. The spirit of contentment is this. It is the thing that makes you balanced in your prayer, in your endeavors, in your acts and positions of faith. It is this balance. This spirit of contentment. It is the peace that comes in that makes it easy for you to look at where you're starting your journey and seeing the end and not being intimidated by anything. Because you have the tools needed to get you from point A to point B in a righteous way.
Yes.
Contentment is the solution to subdue the spirit of covetousness. And it is also the key to having your prayers answered. It is the key to having your prayers answered. The church of late has been in a place whereby prayers are not being answered. Okay, let's look for an explanation. And then we camp on the explanation and we chambua it. You know, we diagnose, we analyze it. We're like, okay, fine. So then we go back, we apply the method again. We pray, prayers are not being answered. Okay, let's go back again and chambua. And you will always find, as long as the heart is a wicked vessel, desperately wicked and deceiving, you will always find a reason why something doesn't work. And it's an abyss. It's a place where you will keep on searching and getting new information about your wickedness or your fallen state. And you won't appreciate the simple and obvious solution to getting God to answer your prayers. Because when God answers your prayers, there is glory that is given to him. But he will not do it at the expense of promoting covetousness. He's not going to do that for the sake of, for example, let's say I have been waiting for 20 years for something because I've not learned the art of delighting in the Lord. And God is like, hey, I'm in Kojasana. Okay, let me just grant the request so that at least he has hope. No. Hey, you'll stay another 50 years until you understand. Because if God promotes covetousness, he might as well just take your life there and then. Because the end result is death. But God wants you to delight in him. Now, I know delighting is, it's those words for, okay, it seems like it's a slow process, arduous process. I don't feel like it has the energy and the pomp that other methods usually are advocated for. Delighting is acknowledging God. It's acknowledging the one who created you. It is acknowledging that everything on this earth belongs to him. He's the one who can bypass every principality, every law. He can suspend every law to ensure you get what you need. That is what God is saying. Delight in the fact that I can make this thing easier. Delight in the fact that I have the wisdom to make sure you use a shorter means to get to where you have. And Bishop has preached that here countless times when he says that the difference between where you are and where you want to go is in your heart. That is what delight in. It's having a place of ease with the person that you're serving. Because if you are not able to delight in God, then you need to ask yourself, am I really saved? Is my name really written in the book of life? Because that's another thing that is not preached often, but maybe we need to start. Because some of us have assumed that napatana hapo pearly gates. What's up? Before you know it, yeah. So, contentment, again, is not accepting the status quo. Because I know some of us may think, does it mean being satisfied with my state as it is and not doing anything about it? No. Contentment is saying that I will be glad in what the Lord has given me in each season. Seasons start and they stop. So in each season, I will be found in the place of gladness and saying thank you to God. You see, the Israelites, I was even sharing with members of the board, God started by giving the Israelites manna. But manna started and it also stopped. But they did not see it as such. They saw manna as something inconveniencing. And they started complaining and asking for more and more and more. Their desire for other alternatives became excessive. It became covetous. And even when they were given that thing that they wanted, which was quails, it is said that, again, they were so excessive in their consumption, meat used to come out from their noses. Miss Jekula Nyama Ivyo, but you guys, that's intense. For you to eat until meat comes out of your nostrils. To the point whereby they still continued. Manna kept flowing. To the point where God was like, Now, none of them are going to see the land that I promised them. Because again, they had not dealt with their covetous nature. There was another mixed multitude who are so desperate to reach their destination that they decided to just bolt. Deuces, Moses, we've gone. Yeah. Then the report comes, they all died. attacked by another tribe on the other side. And that is the 10th instruction. It's a very important instruction for this day. It's also an instruction that advocates for maturity in your relationship with God. It is very easy for me to display a very mature relationship with you here. But in my closet, I am like a baby wearing diapers, running around, doing tantrums left, right, and center. Like, nikitoka prayer closet, hey, Giovanni's suit, man. I'm wearing my things. I'm showing guys, hey, look, I'm mature. But in my prayer closet, I am a mess. And as we talk about relationships, if there's one place of introspect that you also need to have is your own relationship with God, what does it display? Can you be able to audit yourself and say, my relationship with God shows levels of immaturity in how I respond to issues, even before I come to my relationship with man? See, Paul was content. He knew how to abound in much and also in little. And this week I was reading the news and I was hearing some very interesting reports, or rather sad reports. By the way, we need to pray for our police. Some of the headlines are not pleasing. Mara, you hear this guy, the wife, I don't know what did what, goes and shoots. Kianjokoma brothers, there are stories as to what happened, but there was a level of excessiveness and greed. There's a lot of that happening. And if that is happening in our police force, they say in Kiswahili, ukiona mwenzako aki nyolewa, chako kitie maji. We need to pray. We need to pray for our police force. Because this spirit is trying to manifest itself in places of authority and governance. We are on the gun scoop of the sniper. And only God can take us out of it. God is the Alpha and Omega. He knows the start and end to each season. As I said, he's factored your welfare in every season. Whether it looks like your neighbor has more or not, he's factored your welfare. He knew when manna would fall and when it would stop. And he calls us to delight in him. This message is about helping us to become mature in our relationship with God, to enable us to display a different and a distinct countenance as believers. See, the world will try and put an expiry date on your life. It'll make you desperate because of what your senses are going to inform you about your situation. This is where you stand firm and you say, I resist the spirit of covetousness from taking hold of me. I will find myself in the place of delight. I will find my place in the arena of contentment. In 1 Timothy 6, verse 10, when Timothy is talking about this spirit of covetousness, he says it leads to people piercing themselves with more grief. As I started by saying, we have a way of appreciating complex solutions, or rather complex proposals than simple ones. When you allow covetousness to take hold of you, you compound your problem even more. I was reading a story of this blogger, Wash guy. Anyway, this guy was complaining how he had been, if the AC is too low, you can switch on. Agna, the AC is there. Yeah, if he was compounded because he was complaining about how he was desperate for something. He went into a place where guys were doing something illegal, and then he was conned, and then he got mad. And then he started decreeing death. Suji, your mother will never forgive you. I don't know what, Suji, what prayers. And I found it so perplexing. Yeah. The guy was like, ah. So another guy responded, is like, you guys are funny. How is that you guys are telling this guy, tipole sana kwa ile msiba umekupata? Yet he took himself there. He was greedy. He wanted something that obviously he would have gotten from God, but he decided to take matters in his own hands.
Yeah.
He compounded his problem even further and lost even more. God is not a God of loss, he's a God of investment. So if you're experiencing a lot of losses in your life, you need to recheck the approach that you're using beforehand. Resist the enemy and he will flee. Find comfort in the one who owns a cattle on a thousand hills. And I like the song that we've sung, especially the verses where we were decreeing certain things. Because that exercise is what builds contentment in your heart. He's the one who owns a cattle on a thousand hills, who provides for his loved ones while they are asleep, in whose presence the mountains melt like wax. He is the one who commissions angels over you. Why would you decide to opt for another solution? Build contentment in your hearts this day. Build contentment in your prayer closet. Usually when I'm troubled about a matter and I'm thinking I should pray about it, if I cannot find within my heart the capacity to start by giving thanks and praise, I will not pray. I will not pray if I'm not able to give praise. Najua kuna wale, we start the prayers by, God, manze kuna kitu imenisumbua. I don't know what is happening. This needs to change. This needs to change. Fire, thunder upon them. You know, if I cannot approach the presence of God with the assurance of one who he is and give him his due reverence, I would rather just sleep and wake up when I can do that. Because most times what it does is that when you approach God in that way, your perspective slowly but surely starts to change about who God is. To the point where when someone tells you, lift up holy hands and praise God, you can't. Because your heart is too heavy with the issues that are already, the unaddressed issues in your heart. Find contentment. Build contentment in your hearts. And most importantly, as I conclude, delight in the Lord. Some of us have never thought about what it means to have Christ be all that they need, yet we sing it. We've never had the opportunity to experience Christ as one who fully satisfies us, yet we profess it. I would want us to take a different approach. Find wisdom, not even find wisdom. Be very sincere before God as you pray and as you seek, because God wants to release his power upon the body of Christ.
Yeah.
He wants prayers to be answered. He wants songs written of how he is a faithful God. Not that he needs them, but for you, not for him, for you. He wants to release his power, supernatural power, to answer prayers. But it cannot be from a place of covetousness. It can't. That's why it says, you shall not covet. It can't be from a posture of covetousness. It needs to be from a posture of contentment. And that is what I want us, that is my challenge to all of us, including myself. I'm not exonerated or I'm not an exception to this training or this instruction. May we daily, in our meditation of who God is and his word, find contentment in him. I am done with my sermon. Korea, do you mind having Purity and Molly come? And I thank you, O God, as evidenced, O Lord Almighty, by the giving of your people, my Lord. I pray that you would bless the